All right, Brent, we are live. I'm excited. This is Pete from Crunch Time Coaching. And you made a really smart decision today by joining today's call. Brent and myself, we have some, Brent is an awesome instructor, and we have some really valuable tips for you if you've been struggling on your kick serve. And now again, I'm Pete from Crunch Time Coaching. I live here in Atlanta. I coach a lot on the court, and I also am an online instructor. In fact, my YouTube channel has been named Top 10 Instruction Channels by Lessons.com. And we have Brent here who has been playing and coaching for 30 plus years. He's won 7 national titles. He lives in California. He's living the good life. I've been out there. It's really, really nice with his wife, Mai, and they play doubles together. They've actually won some national titles together. So Brent, how are you doing today?
Good, Peter. Hey, man, thanks for inviting me on this call. Looking forward to it. And yeah, we're here in the California desert for the winter, and the weather has been a little strange lately. I mean, we've actually had some rain for a few days, but it's cleared up, and you know, we're all playing this A6 tournament, this big, huge senior tournament this week, 750 plus players.
Wow.
Been backed up a couple days, but today's first day, and the weather forecast looks good to get us through the rest of the tournament.
Good deal. Yeah, I know you've had some bad weather there. My fiance, she's actually finishing medical school out there, and she says it's been rain all the time, and California has no idea how to handle that rain. So
they do not. Anytime there's any rain, the people just freak out when they're driving, and man, you want to stay off the roads.
Well, cool. Well, they didn't listen to us. They didn't join us to talk about the rain. So Brent's going to be helping you guys with your kick serve. He's going to be debunking 7 myths that most recreational players kind of have in their mind about what the kick serve should be. And it really can set some roadblocks towards your improvement. So we're hoping to help you there. And if you stick around to the end, Brent is also, as a reward for just watching us today and giving us your valuable time, he's got a free bonus video training on the kick serve. Before we begin, I want to tell you what you can expect today on today's call. After watching the call, the video we have, you're going to have a clearer picture of what you do need to have a good kick serve and what good kick serve at the recreational level. Isn't that right, Brent?
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, this is this could be a lot of fun. And you know, if anyone out there is really struggling with, you know, that high quality spin, you know, today we're going to show you how to do that.
Yeah. And before we begin, what it's not going to be is if you are out there and you think just watching a video is going to improve your kick serve, well, that's not going to happen. If you're somebody who loves online instruction and really takes the information in and then likes to hit the practice court with the great information Brent's about to share with you today, you are absolutely in the right place. But unfortunately, just through talking, Brent, we can't give people a kick serve like Boris Becker, can we?
Well, it depends.
Okay, Brent is maybe going to give you a kick serve like Boris. Well, I
was thinking more like Edberg, but you know, we'll go with Becker.
I love it. I love Edberg. He was one of my favorite players. So before we get into it, though, Brent, and start to go over these 7 myths that people have out there about the kick serve, I did want to talk about your tennis history or career, how you started, because I think it's going to help a lot of people kind of mentally be able to relate. So tell me.
I was born and raised practically at the Berkeley Tennis Club, but I didn't play a lot of tennis as a kid. I mean, the family was members when I was a kid there, but I played a little bit of tennis, kind of dabbled, but baseball was really my thing all the way through high school. And really did not get going playing tennis until I was in my early 20s. So, no, I was not one of these guys who, played a ton of junior tennis. I mean, I did one summer when I was 14 and played in Northern California. I think I played the great Eric Van Dillen 3 times. And, you know, for your history buffs, Van Dillen played Davis Cup for the U.S. in the early 70s. And he beat me 0-0 3 times in a row in probably about 5 weeks. And I just said, screw this. This is no fun. I'm going back to playing baseball. So, yeah, I mean, I really kind of got a later start, in terms of getting serious about tennis.
So what made you eventually kind of, I mean, you came from baseball, you know, so you're a jock. What made you kind of go, you know what, this tennis is kind of cool. I think I'm going to try and really get good at this game.
Well, you know, when you leave high school and then you're out of college, there's not a lot of opportunity to, you know, call up 17 other guys and play pickup baseball. Mm-hmm. But you know, I'd had a little background, had a little foundation for tennis. So when I finally got home after college, I went back to Berkeley where I was born and raised and just started hanging out every day at the Berkeley Tennis Club, kind of figuring out what it is I wanted to do as a career. Played a boatload of tennis and eventually, not only started learning how to play a little bit better, but, you know, just loved the game and decided I wanted to start teaching and coaching.
Very cool. Very cool. And I think that a lot of people out there, when they see someone like you who's played and coached for 30 plus years and you've won national championships, they just assume that the kick serve, which is so challenging for so many, just probably came to you pretty easy. Was that the case? Did you just, since you could come from baseball, you just have like a natural kick, or was it something
coming from baseball that, you know, that the serve was a natural thing, that the kicker was no big deal, that I could just, you know, bounce the thing over the fence. And that was not the case. I mean, I had an average serve at best, and I had a pretty weak second serve, and maybe that's how I developed, a good transitional half volley, because I was always having to dig one out, playing serve and volley in both singles and doubles. But I really didn't have much of a serve until I had the opportunity to work with Tom Stowe. And Tom Stowe, a legendary coach from Northern California, who unfortunately is no longer with us, but he really helped put the great Don Budge on the map. And again, for you history buffs, Don Budge was the first male to win the Grand Slam. You know, wow. he won all four titles in the same year in 1938. So when I saw Tom Stowe in the early 80s, Tom was, he was in his 80s. And I only had a year and a half with him, about 18 months before he passed away. But he really just rebuilt sort of the whole brand new foundation for my serve. And today we're going to talk about a few things that he helped me with that, you know, after within 2 years of working with Mr. Stowe, I won my first national gold ball, which was the 35 hardcourt double. So no question that what he helped me with on the serve was a huge contributing factor to that first national title.
Very cool. So before we get into the myths, I do just want to touch in that you have won national championships and a lot in doubles. I think some in singles too, but especially if we talk about doubles, why is the kick serve so important at the recreational players, for recreational players, especially in doubles? Why do you think it's a vital serve to have?
Well, I mean, in general, it's just the technique of creating an upspin, topspin, you know, solves both your problems so that you don't double fault, which number one, you've got a higher trajectory going over the top of the net, which is the first obstacle that you got to clear. But then you got to get the ball to come back down inside the service line. And if you've got the right kind of spin, you can solve both of those problems without the ball just sitting up over there on a tee for the returner to unload on and really take control of the point, especially in doubles. And yeah, we could all just kind of bunt in a second serve, but it really wouldn't solve the problem in terms of taking charge of the point. You might eliminate more double faults, but I was writing an article yesterday and saying, look, if I'm going to lose a point where I'm serving, it's almost like I'd rather show the returner a high quality kick spin that's coming in that just misses. All right, I've lost that 1 point, it's a double fault, rather than just kind of pushing or bunting in a second serve. And now all of a sudden they get their confidence built up. My confidence goes down. So absolutely crucial that even if it's not a high nasty kicker, that at least you learn the fundamentals to be able to eliminate double faults in a way that you get a nice high bounce out of that service box. And worst case, the point starts neutral.
Yeah, that's a good point. What you said actually just kind of remind me of Zverev at the Australian Open this year. Andy Murray, now, of course, for most of us, he has a great second serve, but on the pro tour, he does not really have a very good second serve. That's probably one of his weaknesses. And obviously Zverev was coming in on pretty much all of Andy's second serves, where then he played Federer, and Federer's got a great second serve, especially a great kicker. And Federer won actually more, this is very rare on the tour, more points on his second serve than his first serve. He won 64% of his points on the second serve.
Yeah, well, and I think you look back at the great second servers, and Sampras said that was what separated him, and that's what history says, is that's what separated him, was his great second serve. And, you know, I don't think you need to have literally a high, you know, nasty quote unquote kick, but you've got to start off with the fundamentals so that you get that high bouncer, and especially in doubles, it then gives your partner who's starting up at net an opportunity to either fake poach or whatever. And the combination of that high bounce along with a partner who is, you know, not totally literally just covering your alley, but wants to try to create some visual distraction for that returner, you know, it's tough.
Yeah, absolutely. So let's get into this. These are the seven myths that we've come up with, actually Brent did. And so I'm just going to have him take us through it. The first one is, you've got to have the toss above or behind your head to get a high quality topspin serve. You know, I think a lot of people kind of have that image of a rafter, of a Edberg, and they're like, man, that's a backbreaker. You know, yeah. Do I need to do that to have a good kick serve?
Yeah, yeah. Well, I think at that level, at the highest level, at the pro tour level, guys and gals, yeah, I mean, if you've got that kind of world-class strength, that kind of world-class flexibility, and that kind of world-class technique, I mean, yes, you could put it back there. But again, if you look at Sampras or even Federer, I mean, these guys have got great kick serves, and they are not putting the toss way back behind their head. It may be slightly on top of their head, but for the rest of us who maybe don't have that kind of strength, don't have that kind of flexibility, you can easily keep your toss slightly to your side, if not maybe a little bit out in front. And as long as you understand how the racket angle's got to impart the spin, you can absolutely get a high quality spin without needing a high quality up or a high quality top spin, Pete, without the need to put the toss way back behind you. And I've seen so many pros, teaching pros, that's all they teach. And, you know, they're injuring students. Mm-hmm. These students are coming away with shoulder injuries, with lower back injuries. So, no, the myth is not that you've got to be able to, you know, place the toss way back behind you or top of your head to be able to hit a high quality top spin that's got a nice bounce.
Okay, cool. And the other thing is you need to be extremely flexible and have the right racket angle to create a high quality spin. I think, you know, we're talking about a very deep racket drop. A lot of people think you need that to have a good kick serve.
You know, you don't. And typically what happens is players get this sense that, well, if I'm going to really make the ball spin quickly, I got to be pretty strong. I mean, I got to be strong. I got to have some strength. And typically what happens once you get the toss behind you is players tend to grip too tightly in the racket. And now you really slow that swing speed down. So there's no question that you've got to tinker with grips, tension, pressure, strength, whatever the word is. And you got to find one where technique-wise you can create some racket speed without being strong in the handle. Because I don't care how perfect the toss is, how perfect the technique is, if you've got too much grip strength going on as you deliver the – you know, the racket up towards the ball and try to impart that top spin, there's just not enough racket speed.
So working too hard, actually gripping the racket hard is what you're saying is going to work against you. Even though you feel strength and power, it's actually working against you. Is that what you're saying?
It absolutely slows the swing speed down. And this is not a strength move. Getting that kind of high quality spin does not require strength. You just mentioned flexibility. You don't need to have super flexibility like, say, Sampras did, where, you know, he could literally touch his elbows behind his back.
Wow.
You don't need that. Now, you need some flexibility, and the more flexible that you can get, as opposed to stronger, you know, push-ups, weights, whatever that is, you'd be better off in the off-court training stuff getting more flexible. because with the right technique and the right grip tension and the right angle and imparting that spin, if you've got some flexibility, you're going to be able to create a lot more racket speed.
Is there a mental thing you tell yourself or a physical tip that you have that will help people be able to be looser, hold the racket lighter, especially like in a pressure situation? You know, we all tend to just naturally tighten up.
Yeah. Other than spending enough times, and you brought this up really saying, you know, you're not in the right spot here. If you, thinking you're going to listen to this and then go out and all of a sudden it's like a light switch and boom, you've got it. You know, you got to go out in the tennis court with, that bucket of balls or bag of balls, and you got to hit some serves focusing only on, well, let me feel what different grip tensions are like. And you could go from super floppy where it's just barely, if you know, you barely are holding on to the racket, that if any less tension, the racket would go flying out of your hand, to the other extreme, to where you're sort of strong and you're feeling what that strong is. And then you just sort of work different grip strengths so that you're aware when you get into the match, especially when you get into a tight third set and you're trying to close out this match, you now have a reference point as a cue. When you're about to hit that second serve, okay, well, here's the grip tension that I want. And a lot of times when you think of a cue, a technique cue, as you're about to play your serve, rather than, oh man, here it is, it's 40-30, it's match point, it's 5-4 in the third set, and I've just missed my first serve. Well, how many of us kind of go, oh man, please don't let me double fault, mm-hmm. as opposed to, you know, I've just missed my first serve. Okay, what's the cue I want? And one of those cues could be, what's the grip tension that I want, and feel it and then just go.
Yeah. Yeah. But that kind of reminds me when I play. Go ahead, Brent.
I'm just saying that you can't get that reference point and you can't have those sort of cue thoughts unless you spend some time in the practice court really, really sensing what those different feels are for different types of grip strength.
Yeah. And I can tell you that for me on pressure situations, one thing that I focus on is I will tell myself head up. So I concentrate on keeping my head up and the snap. And I also try and picture the serve going in before I serve it. And I find that helps me. And I've just started to kind of do it naturally. And I certainly can miss a decent amount of shots under pressure, but the serve is usually not one. So that has worked for me.
Well, you're a lefty, Pete, and you guys just have this natural stupid ability to hit that nasty lefty. So I don't even know, because you can't even, I mean, you're so natural for you, I don't even know how you can teach it.
Oh, please.
You certainly can't to righties.
Yeah. I can teach it to anybody. Actually, I struggle a lot with the serve when I first started learning how to slice. Okay, so another myth is that you need, and I think when you do watch a serve, especially the kick serve, it does look so physical. You know, I the people I'm picturing in my mind right now are Becker and Edberg and Rafter and Agassi too, and they all kind of had very deep knee bends. To launch himself up to the ball to hit a good kick, do you absolutely have to have that to have a good kick serve?
You know, I don't think you need to have a super deep knee bend, but you do have to have the proper finish position in terms of the tossing motion. And if you have a little knee bend in there, it's good. It gives you a little bit of a rhythm. If you're too straight legged on this thing, it sort of takes away any kind of a rhythm, kind of a tempo in terms of the tossing motion. And then you kind of get in a little bit of a knee bend and then have that nice relaxed grip tension. So I don't believe that you need to have a super deep knee bend. And we see some of these guys on TV and some of the gals as well, who've got just these extreme knee bends. I think at that level, yeah, I mean, they get more out of their serve. So I'm not saying that you shouldn't do it, but I wouldn't worry about that, oh man, this has got to be a huge part of a top spin kick serve technique, is you got to figure out how to get into a deep knee bend. You got to have some, but it's not, it doesn't have to be extreme to be able to really get the ball to have a nice bounce out of that box over there.
Is there anything you focus on with your serve as far as the legs? Is there anything you think about, you know, how deep do you go, or do you know, you know that, or is it something I'm thinking about?
That's a good question, Pete. I don't really, and with students, I really sort of encourage them to find something that feels natural. I mean, the last thing we want to do, especially in the serve where there's so many moving parts, is to take a student out of what feels natural for them. You can certainly, you know, correct certain parts of the serve, but at the same time, you don't want to make it so unnatural for them that, and I found in my experience is that trying to encourage a really deep knee bend can just screw up all the timing and all the other parts. Mm-hmm. So if I do have a student that doesn't have a natural knee bend, and again, like I said before, this is the important part of the knee bend. This might sound a little counterintuitive, is that you really make sure that you finish the tossing motion arm. And
so when you're saying rather than focus on the knee bend, you're saying that really keep coming up. Don't have a short arm.
Usually what happens is where players short arm it is, you know, the ball releases for most people out of their hand on the toss just about head high, maybe a little bit above the top of the head. And some players will stop right away. And even if the toss is perfect, you haven't set your shoulders in the proper setup swing position to be able to swing up to the ball. Mm-hmm. And so what I feel is that there's a combination in that tossing motion after the ball releases out of your hand is that you can sink in the knees to a little bit of a knee bend as you rhythmically in tempo with that tossing arm go all the way up to the finish. And, you know, if you watch the pros, I mean, they finish with that arm straight up in the sky. I was watching Dominique Thiem the other night, and you know, some of these guys finish with it pointing almost slightly backwards.
Like Roddick, right? I did a tip on YouTube where I called it the windy tree, where it's like it's actually going past straight,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. So there's a relationship between finishing the tossing motion and getting into a knee bend, but I am debunking the myth that you have to get into this pro looking level, incredible deep knee bend, because you don't. And yet I'm not saying the opposite's okay where it's okay to be straight leg. I mean, some players, let's be real. Some players who had injuries, and maybe knee injuries or a hip injury or something where they just can't do much of a knee bend. Okay. Well, that's fine. Then, you know, then from there you work into a good finish position with a tossing motion, and you use all the other elements of a good kick serve technique to be able to get what you want, which is that nice bounce out of the service box. Mm-hmm.
Okay, next one is if you choose to play a kicker and you stay back, that then you should immediately kind of get in a defensive position and be ready for a deep return. You're saying that is not something.
Well, I'm saying let's talk about reality. We're not talking about the pro tour. Mm-hmm. And I think if we do look at the pro tour, that when guys hit a kick, second serve, that it's not literally the term stay back in terms of using when we think of stay back. We, you know, we're back behind the baseline. And mm-hmm. I see lots of players at the club level who will hit a decent kick serve or high bouncing serve, but they land because they've got the toss too far back, is they land on top or back behind the baseline. Hmm. And now they have no forward sort of swing path. It's all straight up and they can make the ball rotate. They can get top spin, but it doesn't do very much out of the bounce. It just kind of sits. So Here's what I do, and here's what I think you'll see in the pro tour, and here's what I coach my students, is that with the toss slightly in front, and I know that goes against everyone's thinking, man, you got to toss way behind you. But on that second serve toss, if you keep it slightly in front, not only do you launch everything forward out into the court, you land a foot, maybe 2 feet inside the court, and I'm happy if I'm going to serve and stay back. I want to operate from there because I don't believe that my opponents, even the toughest guys in my age group that I play against, are going to consistently take that high quality, high bounce second serve. and drill it back and make it a tough pickup for me. Mm-hmm. So, and that's just my mindset. My mindset is I'm looking for opportunities to move in. I'm not going to sit back and just rally the ball around waiting for my opponent to eventually miss. That's just not my style. I mean, occasionally I'll go to plan B. If some guy's just, he's just picking me apart when I approach, then that's fine. Then I'll stay back and play plan B, which is to rally. But that doesn't mean that I'm going to change my toss position and put it to where it's not in front. And the beauty of putting the toss in front is you get a much, much better swing speed. And now the technique in terms of the racket angle and parting that spin that you want is much higher quality. And I'm telling you, when you have a higher quality second serve and you that service motion ends up inside the baseline, you get so many opportunities now to take charge of the point. And whether that's you play an approach, and sometimes I'll kick it out wide to the ad side and a guy just scorches one back to me. Well, I go, well, I'm a step forward and play a volley. Mm-hmm. Why wouldn't I do that? I've got him out there. Time is now getting taken away from that player because I'm stepping forward and taking a volley rather than backing up and trying to do a tough little half volley pickup from the baseline. So
right.
I think a lot, and I've seen a lot of players think or tell me, well, you know, if I'm staying back, don't I want to make sure the service motion finishes back there?
Uh-huh.
No.
So it's important to go into the court.
And again, watch Sampras. I mean, watch Fed or any of the guys who really have got a great second serve. And they finish well inside the baseline.
And then finally, one I added is, you know, I think a lot of people think they have to have, because when you hear the word kick serve and just sounds powerful and, you know, you think of the pros that, you know, you're trying to, everybody's always looking for power on their second serve. You know, do you have to have a very powerful serve for it to equal a good kick serve?
Well, look, what are you trying to do, right? You're basically trying to get the ball out of the returner's comfort strike zone, wherever that is. Mm-hmm. And I always assume no matter how good of, you know, and you can feel sometimes you go up and you play it and you can, you don't have to look, but you can feel it coming off of your racket. You just know high quality right there. And you can just feel it, but still I always assume the return's coming back 100% of the time. I never think to myself, well, I'm going to hit something so great here. So I don't put the pressure on myself to have to hit a quote unquote kicker that just completely befuddles the opponent. And it's my way to start the point. Worst case, as I said before earlier, in neutral, where I'm not giving that returner an opportunity to take charge of the point. And so, the less stress, the less pressure I put on myself after I miss that first serve. And now you've got a few seconds to, you could go hugely negative and think, oh man, well, I don't want to miss, or, you know, I better do something great here because this guy's going to take charge of the point and then you double fault, as opposed to, no, this is an opportunity right here to throw in a nice high quality. And I don't even say the word kick to myself. I'm just looking for the bounce. Mm-hmm. I'm looking to get the bounce up and out. And especially in doubles, Pete, when you've got an opponent that doesn't like to take the ball on the rise early off that return, to me, a high bouncing, high trajectory over the top of that high bouncer gives me an extra step to get in to play that first volley. And that opponent knows it. And they know that if they don't hit a really good return, that they're going to be in trouble.
Yeah.
And we're in doubles at least going to have net position first as a team before they do. So lots of times just by throwing it a high trajectory, getting a high bounce, buying you time, you get a lot of sort of forced, unforced errors from that returner. That's not a pro level, quote unquote, kick type of serve.
Yeah. I think you hit a couple of really good points. That idea that you don't have to hit power. You can replace power with height. You know, the higher that ball is going to go over the net, when it hits the ground on the other side, it's going to bounce high. So your ability to be able to hit the ball as high over the net as you can and still keep it in the box is really one of the great skills you can develop in a kick serve. And if you're able to do that, it's giving you the time for you and your partner to really get settled in, and the opposition can feel all that action going on the other side of the net, and so it will create unforced errors there, right?
Well, it does create some unforced errors, but that's, again, my assumption when I hit that second serve and I'm coming in, again, whether it's singles and doubles, and I, you know, obviously in doubles, I come in 100% of the time behind the second serve, and singles not as often as I used to. But I'm just assuming. I'm assuming that they're going to return the serve, and pleasantly surprised when they don't.
Yeah, I think that's a good point too, because I was lucky enough to interview Newcomb, and he was saying that, you know, when he served and volleyed back in the day, it wasn't about getting free points off the serve. It was about the ability to get a volley above the shorts. And if he could get a volley above the shorts, his volley was so good that he felt he was going to win the point 70-80% of the time. And exactly. And certainly a kick serve allows you to do that when you have a good one. Brent, we went through those. Any other final tips that you want to give before we
you know, I guess the final tip is that it really is a simple shot. It's not brain surgery, but there's really a foundation. And then I've kind of found there's sort of five different parts that I've identified that, you know, over my 45 plus years of teaching tennis and coaching, that to focus on these five parts sort of eliminates other stuff that that we could get into, but that if you have this foundation of these five parts, all the other stuff just kind of takes care of itself. And the one word of caution, and we've been talking about this since the beginning, Pete, is that this does require practice. This is not an instant gratification deal. I caution you that when you go out and practice, especially if you start feeling some of this in the beginning, you're going to be sort of pumped up and fired up, and you're going to want to hit a whole bunch more, thinking, well, maybe if I hit, you know, another 50 serves, I'm going to go ahead and, you know, get it sooner than later. You know, serving is especially if you don't have the right grip tension, if you're too strong in the grip, man, you can do some damage. I mean, you can do some damage to your elbow, to your shoulder, to your lower back. I mean, there's a lot of potential injury. Number one, if you overdo practice, and I tell my students, look, 50 max any given time, any given session, 50 serves max. And even if you're feeling you're on the path and you're about to get to, if you could just serve another 50, don't do it. Back off. And just realize that that it's if you really build a good foundation and you do practice on a regular basis, that it's going to happen. You're going to develop in the beginning a nice non-double fault type of topspin serve, and then you're going to progress from there as you practice more and you start to really sense how you can get more racket speed. And again, maybe you tinker with the grip a little bit. It's not continental. Maybe it's a hybrid between continental and Eastern backhand, or maybe for you, it's full Eastern backhand. But the more you stay with it, you're going to develop from a basic, all right, it's in play, I didn't double fault, to eventually, man, this thing's starting to get some bounce. I can now start to control it. I can go to the tee. I can go to the body. I can go out wide. I can start to use this as a first serve. I don't have to bomb first serves that's my strategy. I can now throw in a kicker for a first serve and really use that. But I encourage players not to try to measure how they're doing each and every serve. Just trust. Continue to work on building that foundation that you're going to get there.
Cool. Very good. Well, Brent, thanks so much for those awesome tips. And guys, if you like Brent's information today and found it helpful, I think you're going to love what he has for you today. Brent has created a course on the topspin serve, and I think you are going to enjoy his style of instruction. And we did promise you a free bonus training video today. Thanks for hanging out with us today. We know that tennis is fun stuff, and you know, it's most likely your passion, but also your time is your most valuable asset that you have. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a link in the chat box right now, which could be a technical challenge for me. So bear with me. Brent, while I'm doing that, can you tell the people the motivation behind creating this free training and what they can expect to learn? And I'm going to then go get that link and put in the chat for everybody.
Well, to be honest, the motivation, Peter, was finding new students out there online who are looking to improve their top spin serve. And I wanted to give away, I think, what is a really valuable part of the top spin serve, which is toss placement, along with the shoulders alignment at contact. And so you can have the perfect toss, but you know what happens if you end up opening your shoulders a little bit too early before contact? You really destroy the rest of the technique to make the high quality spin work. So the free tip that I've got is, I can't remember how long it is. It's probably a 5 or 6 minute video. So it's quick. It gets to the point. And we work on toss. I work on the tossing method, which a lot of players just don't get right. Which I was taught by Tom Stowe, because I first went to see Mr. Stowe. I was using the method that I thought, which was the palm, holding the palm up. And I got some fingertip roll in it. I got wrist flick. I got elbow bend. And eventually, with that tossing method, I could get the ball where I wanted to, but I never got into the proper swing position. I never really finished the tossing motion. So part of this video is what I think is the ideal method for lifting your arm up with the ball to get the ball in the proper spot, but to also end up to when you're in just the ideal setup position. And then if you love that instruction, as you mentioned, I do have a course, and right now I've got the course at a ridiculously low price of just $7. And,
wow.
And you know, I mean, I made it $7. A lot of people say, well, why is it $7? And I go, well, I want to make sure it's affordable for every tennis player out there. You know, I don't want anyone to have an excuse to say, well, I can't afford that lesson. Well, $7, if you're really serious about it, about improving your game, you can. Number two, my experience, Peter, I'm sure in yours as well, tennis players who are not willing to invest even a dime in their game typically are not willing to also invest time in terms of experimenting and tinkering and trying to learn something different. So they never really get anywhere. And then thirdly, just like you, you know, if they love this course and they get some tangible benefits, you know, I'm hoping to help that player in other areas of their game as well. So that's the reason it's a no-brainer, $7.
That is pretty much a no-brainer. And I did put it in the chat box successfully. I am super proud of myself. little victories, Brent.
And so
if you're watching this on YouTube, it's literally right next to the video that you're watching right now, and you can just grab that link, put it up in your browser, and get that from Brent. And I want to thank Brent for coming on the call. I do see we have a good amount of people on. If you are so brave and you want to ask a question, which is right next to the video, all you have to do is just type in where it says say something. We will see it. There might be a little bit of a delay. It looks like there is a little bit of delay because now I'm on the actually on the page. And we'll hang around for a couple of minutes, answer some of your questions. You can ask either Brent or myself a question. And so there you go. So we'll hang around for a couple of minutes. And Brent, I really want to thank you for being on today's call.
Well, Pete, you know, I love doing this stuff. Just love teaching tennis, coaching tennis, and seeing players, you know, whether it's just a little bit better or over time making some significant changes in their game. I mean, just like you, Yeah, I love it. I just love seeing players improve and sort of that great feeling that people get when they put a little time into something and they actually get a little bit better at whatever part of their game they're working on, and just makes it so much more fun for them every time they step out in the court. So
very cool.
I love doing this.
Well, we do have a question from Matt Bradshaw. We have two. Okay. We got two comments. What are some of your favorite spots to hit on the kick serve and why? Both Brent and Pete. Okay. So you go first and then I'll go.
Yeah. And well, you know, it kind of depends. If it's singles we're talking about, you know, and I'm going to serve and volley or I'm going to serve and stay back, but look for something short. I definitely love going out wide, you know, and I just love taking someone out there. And I almost hope, whether it's in the ad side or the deuce side, I hope they give me some pace, you know, and lots of times players will do that. The returners will do that. They'll go out there and just drill it thinking that's the way to overcome it. Where, you know, for me, I'm going, well, thank you very much. I've got the ball and you're still hung out to dry out there, maybe in the alley. So I like that. That takes pressure off of me, whether it's a transitional volley or half volley or maybe even an approach shot. And then in doubles, you know, I love serving to the body. I love that kick serve, that high bouncer to the body, because it forces the returner to have some good footwork to get out of the way of it. And you know, when they don't have good footwork or they don't have super precise footwork, just kind of lean out of the way. Now stroke mechanics get, you know, kind of get destroyed. And so I'm looking, not only am I trying to get the ball up and out of their comfort zone, but I'm also trying to force them into having really good footwork to create the spacing, for them to have better stroke technique. And again, like I mentioned before earlier, Pete, combined with a partner who's up at net, who loves to fake poach or who loves to show an early fake. And, you know, here's this kicker, this high bouncer coming right at them. And the whole visual landscape out there is getting muddled up, is getting dirtied up by my partner. I think that is just a great play in terms of where to play that high bouncer in doubles.
Yeah. Very cool. We do have a couple more things. I'm going to tell you where I like to hit the kick serve by using the board. We had Jerry say he enjoyed the discussion and he's looking forward to spending his $7. And then we have a question on the ball toss placement being a little more specific. But let me get back up on the board here for you guys so you can kind of see. I'll try and do a visual for you. Okay, there I am. I want to make sure. Okay, so as a lefty, when I'm staying here, one of my favorite serves is to hit a slice up the middle and it curl away. And then my kick serve, I'll usually stand a little more out here. Most people can't pick up on that right away. And I try and get it off the court there, kind of like Brent was saying, you'll get it off the court, get out of their strike zone. But then another one I like to do is toss the ball up and have it bounce here to where a lot of people don't see the swing path. They don't, the better players will, but some people don't pick up on this to where it's going here. So they anticipate it going there because I've been doing that all match. I don't toss it as far over my head like Brent, you know, talked about. And I will kick it into their body. So, you know, that's kind of cool because a lot of times I'll catch them getting their momentum going this way because some of my slices can go off the court there. But then it actually jumps back into them. And, you know, I like to serve in volley too. And so that creates a lot of high balls right around in here that I can then usually put away. So hopefully you guys can develop that as well. And Brent, could you be a little more on the ball toss, where it should be specifically? I don't know. You can maybe
Sure. Yeah. Well, it's probably easier if you click through that link that Peter's put up there. You'll go to that free video and you'll see, because I think the opening first 15 or 20 seconds is a camera angle behind me as I'm practicing my second serve, and what you'll see is that it's more important to think about putting the toss slightly in front, whether against, you know, if you're a right-handed player, whether you think about tossing it to 1 o'clock or 12 o'clock, that's fine, or some variation in there. But what I encourage players to do first is to tinker with getting the toss out in front. And one of the things you'll see in this complimentary video is the need that once you get it out there in front is to make sure that your shoulders stay closed at contact, meaning that you haven't, if you're a right-handed player, that you haven't started to, you know, take that front shoulder, the tossing arm shoulder, and open it too early, which players have a tendency to do once that toss gets out in front. And once you do that, if you still continue to try to hit a spin with your shoulders open, you're hitting that serve due left. I mean, you're going into the next court to your left. So you've got to make sure with that toss slightly in front that you keep the shoulders closed at contact. And yeah, I mean, you do end up turning forward, but you've got to work on when do you make that turn forward. And so I think you'll see exactly where I toss in that complimentary video in terms of out in front, as well as it's not on top of me, you know, it's maybe 12 o'clock in front of me. Probably not doing a great job articulating it, but if you go to that video, you'll get a real clear view.
Yeah. John kind of asked a similar question, same John on the toss. And I would just encourage you to go to the video. I'm going to put the link again right in here. We're going to sign off because I did watch Brent's video. He's got a very good visual on it. He's on the court. So if you're looking for a real like detail of how is he doing it, the best thing to do is to go there and opt in for that training, because you get to see Brent on the court. You get to see him hitting serves. He's got different camera angles, and he's explaining things verbally as he's showing you. And so that's the power of online instruction, is you can really, you know, watch it and go, okay, that's exactly what I need to do, and then hit the practice court. So, Brent,
let me take the power of online video one more step, Peter. Okay. No question that when players go and watch online, you get an idea of what you want to be doing. But the real power comes, and this is super off topic, but the real power comes from using this. And whether you have someone hold your phone for you, put it on video, or whether you have a little tripod where you set up your phone there, the real feedback is going to be seeing yourself. And you can certainly study you can study me, you can study anyone else, but you're not going to know if you're doing the thing, whatever it is that you're trying to work on, unless you can get some feedback by seeing yourself. And I had a student the other day who takes lessons here in the desert from a teaching pro, and I encouraged him. I said, look, you need to see yourself on video, because he said, well, my teaching pro keeps telling me, well, you know, I'm not far enough out in front. And I was telling the guy, would you shut up? Cause I'm way out in front. Well, then he saw the video and he goes, oh man, I'm not out in front. Mm-hmm. So that's another coaching tip that, I mean, if you want to accelerate your improvement curve, you got to get feedback seeing yourself on video. And my gosh, I mean, cell phones now, the video quality is so great. You get instant feedback right then and there.
Yeah, and there's awesome apps out there like Coach's Eye, which you can download for free or for like $4.99. And you know, this technology back in the day would literally cost someone thousands of dollars to get, and you can get it for like nothing or next to nothing. So great time with you today, Brent. We're going to end it there. I put the link in the chat discussion now twice, so you guys can look at that right next to the video. And that's it. We're gonna sign off. It's lunchtime for me, Brent.
Let's see what time we got out here. 9:49 out here in the California desert. Got to go out and hit a few balls. Get ready to play a match at 2 o'clock today.
Oh man, life is tough. All right, guys, take care. We'll see you later.
Thanks, Pete.